All right, dear hearts. I want to thank everybody for joining me this morning for Shalom Morning Prayer. I'm your host, Evangelist King. I'm a deliverance pastor. Some of you wonder, who am I? And I say a female exorcist, but I'm a deliverance pastor as well. You know, a lot of you turn off with that female exorcist, but remember, I am a female, and I am an exorcist. And you know what? If you believe in Jesus Christ, you believe in the very same works that he done, he also can do it through us. He said, these signs shall follow them who believe. Then he said, in my name, they shall do what? They shall cast out devils. They shall heal the sick. They even shall raise the dead. Freely they have received, freely you give. So what is an exorcist? Someone who casts out devils. So you are a believer in Christ Jesus. You are an exorcist too. It's not just given to just one individual or certain people. Every child of God is an exorcist. Now, you just don't go out making it a ministry. Now, that commands come from our commander, our master, Savior, Lord Jesus Christ. When you know, when the Lord wants you to make it a ministry. But these signs will follow you. You will be an exorcist. But here at House Shalom, remember House Shalom, you know, we simply building God a peaceful house. You know, you want your house to be peaceful. You want no devils manifesting in your family and cause turmoil in your house. You want to live at peace in your house. Well, God's house is our body. That's his temple. That's his dwelling place. That's where he lives to and resides in to manifest and act through our body. And he's not going to coexist with them in our body. You know, he don't just want to be in our spirit while the devil is raising hell in our mind, in our will, in our emotion, and in our body. No. God once told me, Terry, I have some of you, but I don't have all of you. God wants all of us, spirit, soul, and body. Because that's what we consist of. We consist of spirit, soul, and body, John. So at House Alone, we make you aware to be mindful every day whose you are. Who you belong to, who lives in you. The great I am lives and reigns in you. And I think if we're careful about that, we think about that every day, I think we'd be careful about what we do in God's house and what we put on God's house. Remember Jesus said, I am true, he is truthful. So we're supposed to be true on the inside as well as true on the outside. So no child of God don't have any business wearing anything false on the outside, women of God. That means no false hair. God gave you your hair, gave us our hair. We want it longer. Just ask the one who gave it to us. Lord, could you make my hair a little longer, please? Lord said, nothing is impossible to them that believe. You want it curly if you believe. He'll make it curly. He said, nothing is impossible. And it's not, but you must believe. So Shalom Morning Prayer, we come together corporately and pray as the Holy Spirit lead us. After, you know, the Holy Ghost through me bring a little light teaching because our faith must be built in the Word of God. You know, you should love the Word of God. Just like you love to eat, you devour food. But the Word of God is food to our spirit, to hope. It's our life, the Word of God. Because Jesus said, I am the Word. That's the only way faith is going to come as we hear the Word of God. Do you not know you can watch many deliverance sessions? You know, that don't build your faith in God. It just lets you know who he is. But the Word that comes through, the Word of the living God that is spoken, that's when faith comes. Deep down on the inside of you, and you will believe for the impossible. So faith in God comes as we keep hearing, not as we heard, but as we keep hearing the Word of God. You know, you can listen to something over and over again. Holy Ghost can give you more revelation of it. But remember, God just give us a word of his knowledge, fragmentary, part, piece, not his total mind. So we are forever learning. Never say, well, I heard that before. Well, if you keep hearing, you hear even more of that which you heard before. I have experienced that many times. Because the Holy Ghost always ready to give us more revelation of truth. He leads us into all truth. But just because you heard something before, don't think you have heard it all. No, there's more to it. And Holy Ghost will reveal it to us. As we humble ourselves, we must humble ourselves and hear the teaching of God's word. Again, we should be more excited in listening and seeing someone minister the word of God. You know, when someone recommend me to watch a video, praise the Lord, I look for the word coming forth through them. I be looking, be listening. Okay, Lord, I don't hear the word of God. I mean, they could be casting out devils, but I'm still looking for the word. After you cast out them devils, you have to bring the word to teach those people the word of God to maintain their deliverance. Yeah, I'm looking for the word. That's my life. That's our life. That's how we live. That's how we flourish. Praise the living God. Now, today's prayer point is called faith, patience, and godliness. And I'm coming from Hebrews, the 12th chapter. The Lord talking to his chosen people, you Hebrewites. The group that's called Hebrewites. You know, if you just get in the word of God, especially Hebrews, the Lord tell you, Hebrewites, you know, don't get caught up in any set, S-E-C-T. Only get caught up in the word of God. If you notice any set, S-E-C-T, they are established, or their foundation is established on a certain scripture reference. And that's not true. We can't pick and choose what we want to hear, or what we want to believe. We have to devour the whole word of God, the entire word of the living God. So Hebrews the 12th chapter, faith, patience, and godliness, the Holy Spirit through his apostle Paul, really is encouraging our brethren, encouraging us today. Because remember, God said he's the same as he was yesterday. He's the same today. You know, I just thank God for himself, because his word is himself. He said, I am the word. The 12th chapter, verse 1 says, wherefore then we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses. We have the blood of Jesus on this earth is our witness. We have the word is our witness. We have water. The living water is our witness. You know, we have one another. We surrounded by a cloud of witnesses. That's why there's nothing that we do, even in secret, that has not have been seen and will not be revealed. So we're just gonna be excuses before God. Remember, always remember that. There's a cloud of witnesses. So therefore, he said, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us, and let's run with patience the race that is set before us. Now, knowing we surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses, we supposed to. Every little thing, you know, if something get on your nerve, and we need to endow ourselves in the word of God so that something won't get on our nerve. You know, we're good for saying, you get on my nerve. You know, if something get on your nerve, you're going to die. Think about what you're saying. So stop saying that. You get on my nerve. Yeah. If something get on your nerve, it will squish your nerve and you will end up dying. So anything that easily, you know, cause us to sin, especially we know we have a weakness, we're supposed to turn away from it. Turn away from it. And turn away from that sin. And we need to run with patience. Run with patience. Continue to maintain our faith in God when we're going through diverse kinds of trials and tests and temptations. We need to be patient. That patience have its perfect work. 2 tells us to look unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. See, regardless of what we're going through, we don't need to look on that circumstance, but look to Jesus. Now remember, Jesus is the author in the finish of our faith. He's the one who started our faith. He's going to end our faith. But he doesn't tell us what he's going to do in between to perfect our faith. Our faith in him must be perfected. He knows exactly what to do. Now, what he does allow to happen in my life to perfect my faith may be totally different what he allows to happen in your life to perfect your faith. But in either case, he told us to run this race with patience. You know, be patient. Be patient. Always, again, looking to him. You know, look at those circumstances, but look to him. Who, for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross. Jesus endured the cross. He didn't look at that cross. He looked at the end result of what was going to happen, the joy that was going to take place. And that was his target. That's what he kept in mind. You know, and that's what we need to do, dear heart. We need to keep in mind of our reward, our heavenly reward that our heavenly Father has for us. So Jesus, he endured the cross, despising the shame. Come on now. God took on humanity. You know, if you look in the human eye, that was shame. Here you say you God and you've been crucified on a cross, almost stripped naked. But he despised that shame. You know, he did not give in to the devil and being shamed for it. And here you are. You know, God told you to come get deliverance. And you not despising the shame. You say, well, I don't want to be seen. I don't want to be heard. You know, this is private. Well, when Jesus hung on that cross, that wasn't private. It was public for everybody to see. And praise the living God. That's why you and I today are in the condition that we are in because of his shed blood. Because of him despising the shame. So if he despised his shame, then we must despise our shame, dear Lord. And he sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. See, he looked toward that heavenly reward. That's why he despised the shame. We must look for that heavenly reward. So, dear Lord, we're going to go through something. We have an enemy here. Now, an enemy that we can't even see. You know, you would say, but that's so unfair, this battle. I can't see the enemy. No, we can't see it, but God can. And that's all it takes for us is to continue to have faith in him. That's why I said, looking unto Jesus. Looking unto Jesus. Look to him. Jesus sees for us. Our faith is in him. So this journey we end is by faith. It's not by our circumstance. You know, there are many people who actually think it's because they are blessed financially, because they are blessed with the house they want, the husband, the wife, the children they want, the career they want. They look at that as their evidence that God is pleased with them. You know, that's not true. That is not our evidence that God is pleased. The one thing that pleases God, and that is when we have faith in him. When we don't have faith in him, we cannot please him. Because faith in him what pleases him. So our evidence that God is pleased with us is our faith in his word. Now, the blessing comes attached to it. God will bless us with a nice home, nice career, nice family. But that's not our evidence that he pleased with us. The only evidence he pleased with us is our faith in his word. Look at Lazarus, who was poor, homeless man, and the rich man. It looked like, in the rich man's eyesight, looked like Lazarus was not pleasing to God, but the rich man thought he was pleasing to God because he was comfortable in that nice place, food to eat. And many times he probably looked out his window and saw Lazarus, that poor man. If he would do the right thing, he would be blessed. You know, poor man. You see? And look what happened. And look where the rich man ended up. And look where Lazarus ended up. Lazarus' faith pleased God. The rich man did not have no faith in God. He had riches. And he looked at his riches or things that he desired as his evidence that God is pleased with him. So he was satisfied. But that is not God's evidence. So when God blesses us like that, say, thank you, Jesus. You only bless me because I believe your word. Because what happens when you take all of that away? Are you still going to be thankful then? Will you? Lord allow you, just like you did Job. Now the devil take them things away from you so that you can see where your faith really lies. Your faith really lies in his word. And your faith relies in the things that he can give you. Praise the living God. Remember, this is faith, patience, and godliness. Three faithful. Consider him that endures such contradiction of sinners against himself, lest you be weary and faint in your mind. See, we have to, when we go through things, when we go through hardships and trials and tests, we have to reflect back on Jesus Christ. We have to look unto Jesus, how he endured the cross, how he endured being spit on, being called all manner of name except the Son of God, how he endured. And right now he's sitting on the right-hand side of the Father. So we have to look unto him. When we're going through our times of testing, when we go through our little cross, you know, we got cross. Compared to Jesus Christ, our cross is very little. Lord said, take care of your cross and follow me. So we're going to have a cross just like Jesus. But the good thing about it, we have already overcame because he has overcame. We're not overcomers. We actually have overcame because he has overcame. So we have to always think on him, not on whatever we're going through. Because if we think on what we're going through, we will get weary and faint in what we're doing. We'll go back and sin again. That's why we have to always look unto Jesus. Hurting on the inside, but we look unto Jesus. See, many of y'all see me. You say, Vince King's show is in a joyful mood all the time. But you only can see what's on the outside. But you don't know what's going on the inside. There's a battle going on in the inside that is raging. But every word of God says, I have learned to look unto Jesus, who is the author and the finisher of my faith. My joy is in the Lord. My joy is not in my circumstances. And then when we do that, we'll be able to be just like Jesus, walk with patience through the hard times and problems and troubles. Praise the living God. For say, you have not yet resisted unto blood, striving against sin. See, our brethren then and our brethren now, we have not learned to resist unto blood. Strive against sin. I mean, coming against it. It's a battle. It's a war. Sin, you have no dominion over me. Strive, you know. No, it's not easy. But Jesus has made it easy. That's why the Lord is telling us to look unto him. He's the author and finisher of our faith. Now, some of you're in a double battle because the enemy is still in you. What you mean, if I'm saying enemy, still enemy? Now that means you've never been delivered from demons that is still residing in your soul, which is your mind, will, emotion, body. And that makes it even worse because the battle is not on the outside of you. The battle is raging on the inside of you. So the first thing needs to be first. You already submitted your spirit to the Lord. Now you need to get those demons out of your mind, will, emotion, and body. Once they get out, now you can flow much better in the things of God. It won't be as difficult to fulfill your destiny in him. But when those demons are on the inside of you, dear heart, you do what they want you to do. Five say, and you have forgotten the exhortation which speaketh unto you as unto children. My son, despise not thou the chastening of the Lord, nor faint when thou art rebuked of him. God chastened those who he loved. Our brethren then and the brethren now. When God corrects us through his servant, we were despised. And I believe, well, I know, what makes one despise it? When I think about my own self and I despise his chastening, though demon spirit was in me. When demon spirits are in you, you will despise the chastening of the Lord. You will despise when the Lord through his servants rebuke you in love. When demon spirits are in you. But when they're out of you and God corrects you, you say, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. And that is true. I'm saying it clearly now because I'm free now. But before I got free, I did not like the chastening of the Lord. I did not like the Lord correcting me. And I found it over myself, the Lord help me because I just don't like what you're saying. Now, I did not know when I asked the Lord to help me. I was actually asking the Lord to cast those demon spirits out of me. Because you don't think demon spirits are in you. I didn't think those demon spirits were in me when I despised the correction of God. But they were. So when I asked him to help me to love his chastening, his correction, I actually was asking him to cast those spirits out of me. And lo and behold, as time went on, that's what he did. He sent me to his servant. And now, dear heart, I love his chase. I look at his correction as love. He loved me. He loved us. So he loved our brethren then. He loved us today. So we're not supposed to despise the chastening of the Lord. Nor our faint get all upset when we are rebuked. And I've been rebuked when they were in me, and I've been rebuked when they was out of me. And I see the difference again. When they was out of me and I rebuked, I say, yes, Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. So I say, if you endure chastening, that means if you endure correction, God deals with you as with sons. For what son is he whom the Father chases not? But that's why God deals with us, because we are his dear son. You know, it includes daughter too. You know, the man represents headship. So it's the level of authority. The reason why the Lord says son, that means daughters too. But if you be without chastisement, whereof all are partakers, then are you bastards and not sons? So when we don't want God to chastise us, to correct us, to his servant, we're just like a bastard. Person who don't have a father. Mm-hmm. And the devil don't have a father. So he's a bastard. He rejected his heavenly father. So don't get angry when the man or woman of God in love corrects you. You know, by the Holy Ghost, I know a lot of you women are very upset with Vanish King because the Lord have heard her talk about this false hair, which you love so much. And not only false hair, but even your hair, and you use demonic hairstyles. You get angry. Some of you say, well, I wear my hair the way I want to wear it. And you wear your hair the way you want to wear it. I have this one Facebook sister, the Lord told her, she obeyed at first, but she gave in to that temptation. And when I see her, she wearing that false hair. And that's rebellion. She got the spirit of rebellion, and she thinks she's doing the will of God. But it's rebellion. You know what? Rebellion is as witchcraft. Satan is a rebellious one. Just because you see other people maybe wearing the false hair and you think they seem to be, everything is calm and cool and collected. And you say, well, why can't I? Well, God's talking to you. The other people is not your concern. You're going to give an account to the knowledge of truth that you know. And they're going to give an account to the knowledge of truth that they know. So when it comes down to God's children, we're not going to get away with things. And we may see somebody who in the world, just come out of the world, but they lack knowledge in this area, and they are doing those things. And we say, well, they're doing it. Actually, that's none of our business. They just haven't come to that knowledge yet. Now, and if they keep on in the Lord, the Holy Ghost will bring them to this knowledge. When the Lord said, when you seek me with all your heart, then I will, other words, make myself known to you. So that's why you see some of your sisters deal with this false hat. These first lady, you even see prophets, well-known prophetesses on television, false hair. The Lord said, when they seek me with all their heart, then I will give them this knowledge. Because, dear heart, we represent a true God. So we need to reflect him inside and out. Yes, God is concerned about what we put on his house. He's concerned about what we put on our body. He told us to dress modest. First of all, would I go to hell if I wear false hair? No, false hair is not going to send you to hell. What's going to send you to hell is your rebellion against truth, refusing to obey truth. That's what's going to send you to hell. Praise the living God. Now I say, furthermore, we have had fathers of our flesh which corrected us, and we gave them reverence. Shall we not much rather be in subjection to the Father of spirits and live? Be subjection in subjection to obeying truth through whoever God put truth through. As I talked to a dear sister, I had a session with her on yesterday, Shanika. Except that I posted it this morning on my YouTube. Be sure to watch Shanika's session. Shanika did it from Spirit Husband. And then I put a link to her first session about a year ago. You should listen to that one. But at least on the first session, Shanika confessed and admitted that she needed to be delivered. But the second session, she didn't think she needed to be delivered. She didn't think that spirit was back again. I told her it was back, because the Holy Ghost told her it was back. She didn't believe me. I got the prayer about it. You know, now I know who it is that tells you, I got the prayer about it. When a woman or man of God tell you something that the Holy Ghost has told you, and you say, I got the prayer about it, I know who it is now. I told the Lord, I said, Lord, that's who that is. Who said that? He said, yes. Yeah. He said, who it is? Watch the Nico session. Watch it. And that spirit that manifested and told me to shut up as I call out its name. And that's the spirit who tells you, when a man or a woman of God tells you something that God told them to tell you that you need to stop doing, you need to do, and you say, I got to pray about it. That is not the Holy Ghost. That's that particular spirit. See, that's the Lord correcting you. Because see, God wants to clean us inside and out. When he come back, dear, well, he coming back for a church without spot or wrinkle. I mean, he coming back for a house, a building, a temple. Without spot, without wrinkle. I mean, no demon spirits, period. In our spirit, soul, and body. And God knows who's in us. And by him loving us, he chastises us. He corrects us. Praise the living God. 10 say, for they verily for a few days, chasing us after their own pleasure. But he for our profit, that we might be partakers of his holiness. See, that's why the Lord chastises us, corrects us, because he wants us to be partakers of his holiness. He wants us to be holy. But we say holy, 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 like the angel. Those words are not coming from my mere mouth. It's coming from my spirit, coming from my being. Holy, holy, holy. And I want you to say that. I want you to, from your heart, say, holy. Now, if you got any hesitation, you feel any hesitation, any hardship to bring out holy from deep down within, that's evidence. You need to be delivered. Because demons don't, they're not holy. And when they're in you, they're not allow you to say, be holy. Not from your being. You can speak it from your lips. I'm not talking about from your lips. These words are coming deep down from within. Holy! 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 It's coming deep down from within your heart. Again, if you say it and there's a problem, that means you need to be delivered. This is the chastening of the Lord. I think I named it the chastening of the Lord. And Lord wants to conform you to his holiness, his righteousness. That would say, now no chastening for the present seems to be joyous, J-O-Y-O-U-S. For the present, of course not, because devils are in us. So we're going to get angry. But grievous. Why? Because devils are in us. We need to be delivered from them. That's why we despise the chastening of the Lord, the correction of the Lord. Nevertheless, afterward, after the Lord set us free, we receive and correct his chastening, his correction. When we receive it, allow the Holy Ghost to do his perfect cleansing work on the inside of us, then it will yield the peaceable fruit of righteousness unto them which are exercised thereby. The result, we experience the fruit of the Holy Ghost. Love, joy, peace, contentment, temperance, patience. Praise the living God. 12 say, wherefore? Other words, on this note, lift up your hand, which is hanging down in your feeble knees. Because this is good news. And make straight paths for your feet, lest that which is lame be turned out of the way, but let it rather be healed. You know, looking to Jesus, who is the author and finisher of our faith, we look to him during our hard times and tests. We receive his chastisement, his correction. Then we need to continue to look to him. We need to hold up our hand and praise him. Get off. Get off your knees and praise him. A lot of times we just on our knees begging God, help me, Lord, help me. Get off your knees and praise him. Thank him because he loves you. He cares for you. Again, he wants us to be holy, for he is holy. 14, they follow peace with all men in holiness. With no man shall see God. See, without holiness, we're not going to see God. You know, we're going to have to be holy. Now, I know these churches who say they are based on holiness have turned you off with holiness. And that's why you have to look unto Jesus, not looking unto denominations. Look unto Jesus. Because without holiness, no person is going to see God. We must be holy, inside and out. 15, looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God. Lest any root of bitterness spring up trouble you, and thereby many be defiled. So we don't keep our eyes on Jesus. This is what's going to happen, because we keep our eyes on our circumstances. Then that bitterness is going to enter, take root into our heart. Again, that's why some of you fell out with holiness. Fell out with faith. Because of the devil through people labeling certain groups of people, faith people, holiness people, tongue talkers. You fell out with it all. That root of bitterness. The Lord said, look unto him. Because we need all those things. We need faith. We need hope. We need to speak in new tongues. We need it all. So we need to start looking at others, and then start looking at our circumstances, and look unto him so that we don't be defiled. Because remember, the Lord said, without holiness, we're not going to see him. Lest there be any fornicator or profane person like Esau, who for one morsel of meat sold his birthright. Profane person. You know, you might not sell your birthright because you want a bowl of food, but a lot of times, one sells a birthright because maybe wanting to smoke a cigarette. Smoke a cigarette. Go in and drink some beer to get drunk. Go fornicate. Whatever it may be. What's that? You're a profane person. But you know how that after war, talking about Esau, when he would have inherited the blessing, he was rejected, but he found no place of repentance, though he sought it carefully with tears. So you better be careful. Be careful choosing to sin, especially after the Lord has delivered you, and you keep on sinning. The Lord said the worst thing will happen. And I see the worst thing is you never desire to be delivered again. This thing that Esau did was so terrible in the sight of God. He sought for repentance with tears. Afterwards, he was so sorry with tears. He gave up his birthright for a bowl of soup. You know, I talked with my daughter. She had been delivered 5 times. And you know, I watched the laying on hands meeting. A demon manifested. Because before then, the Lord said, take Mary from behind the camera and lay your hands on her. Pray for her. Because I knew she needed delivered. Before I could get to her, that demon manifested. But God set her free. So later on, we got to talking about it. Remember the devil saying, she's not going to tell. But she told. And you know how the devil got her? You know what? Please, stay submitted to God. The mirror would have been fine. She would have continued reading and endowing into his word, consuming his word. But she would, in the mornings, at night, she would consume his word. But then I noticed she began not to consume his word in the mornings and before she went to bed. The Lord said, don't say nothing. Don't say nothing. So I didn't. But something very simple, just like Esau, the devil got it. Young man on her job starts saying, Miriam, I bought you a cookie. A chocolate chip cookie. And she loved chocolate chips. She said, Mama, something said, don't take that cookie. Mama, I took the cookie anyway, and I began to eat it. So he would do it nearly every morning. So one morning he did it, and one of my co-workers saw me and she said, "You know, he always tried to buy me stuff too, but I never take it." And the man said, "Yeah, I buy her stuff, but she never takes it." She said, "No, I never take it." So, Mama, I heard the girl when she said it, but I was still eating that cookie. After she heard, the Lord said, "Don't take that cookie." And it went on for a week. Every morning, he would buy something and give it to her. She'll eat it. So what happened? That was the devil web that he used to lure her. Something simple, just like Esau. But praise God, unlike Esau, God set her free. So by her taking that cookie, eventually she went into sexual sin. Dear heart, don't be taking gifts from men and women. Buy your own cookie. Say thank you, but no thanks. Because Satan got a trap attached to that. I mean, something simple. But if she had continued to have been abiding in truth in God's word like she used to do in the mornings and at night, and then she would have been able to resist that temptation. He said, "Vashti, why are you telling us this?" "Because it's the truth. You need to know. It don't matter if she's my daughter. If it was somebody else's daughter, I would share that same testimony." Praise the living God. But God is wanting you to start taking gifts from women and men. Just say thank you and no thank you. Especially when they are ungodly. When their fruit shows you it's not of the Holy Ghost. The Lord said you should know them by their fruit. And their fruit is not of the Holy Ghost. You don't take their gifts. You got daughters. You teach your daughters that. Don't be taking nothing from you men. Sons, start eating those women food. Cooking you food. The women do the same thing. I did a session on this young girl, and Megan even told everybody on her Facebook that she kept her boyfriend by putting curses on him. And I'm pretty sure she did, she concocted food and gave it to him. You be careful about that. No one is somebody. And come and get delivered. Amen. So 18 says, "For you are not come into the mount that might be touched and that burn with fire, nor into blackness and darkness and tempest, and the sound of a trumpet and the voice of the words, which voice they that heard entreated that the words should not be spoken to them anymore. But they could not endure that which was commanded. And if so much as a beast touched the mountain, it shall be stoned or thrust through with a dart." And so terrible was the sight that Moses said, "I exceedingly fear and quake." You know, we're supposed to fear the Lord. Fear the Lord and begin to live. I can sin if I choose to, but I don't want to, and I'm scared to. You know, if we really truly know who God is, we would fear him, and we would fear him to the point, I'm not going to sin against God. No. He loves me. But if I sin against him, I don't know what's going to happen. No. I fear God. I'm not going to sin. And you're supposed to fear God. Reverence him with fear, and also fear him. The devil fear God and tremble. So they know what God can do. But we are God's children, just like with our children. They don't fear us because they say, "Mama, Daddy love us." You know, so they won't do no harm to us. They won't deny us. So they do whatever they want to do. When it shouldn't be that way. It should fear us. "No, I'm not doing that because Mama and Dad will spank me if I do that." "No, they'll punish me if I do that. I'm not doing that." Well, we're supposed to fear God. "No, I'm not doing that. God's word will punish me because he said in his word when we disobey him, in Deuteronomy 28, these things what's going to happen to us. No, I'm not going to do it. I fear God. But some of you just don't fear God whatsoever. You go to church, whether it's Sunday, Saturday, or Wednesday night, and you call yourself worshiping and praising Him, then you go back home and sleep with someone, not your spouse. That's dangerous. I'm not putting my mouth on you. But if you continue, you're going to drop dead. There's no fear of God. Get on Facebook, pretend to be you're so holy and righteous with the Pope, but off Facebook, you cursing every moment you get, you backbiting, you gossiping, you angry, you mad. It's totally the opposite. There's no fear of God. Lord said, without holiness, no man would see Him. See, this is the chastening of the Lord. He's coming back again for a building, a temple, without spot, without wrinkle. So we need to fear Him. We need the fear of the Lord. Stop being righteous. Being righteous. I mean, you're not righteous. Spirit in you, if when you pray, it's not even coming from your heart, coming from your mind, because it has a certain tone to it where you're being all righteous. Just pray. That's all you do, just pray. A lot of you women, you mess up your marriage by being so righteous, self-righteous. The Lord told me many, many years ago, before I think this was after I got to the altar. You know, in appearance rise, it looked as though I was more, like I said, spiritually than my husband. And so, I didn't realize I was doing this, but I didn't give him time to do what he should be doing as man of the house, and I would just do it. And, you know, job-wise, I always made more money than he made. So, I would just get stuff. Take care of this, take care of that. You know, without talking to him about, just do it because I made more money. One day the Lord said, Carol, you are not the head of the house. I said, what? You are not the head of the house, so stop acting like it. You are not the husband. You stop doing what you're doing and allow Roger to do it. As long as you do it, he's not going to do it. I said, Lord, forgive me. And I stopped. Regardless of how much money I made, I stopped. I let him do it. Now I helped him, but I stripped myself of that responsibility, feeling that I had to do those things because maybe I was more spiritual or I was making more money. I did. I stopped. I sure did. And then he started doing those things. See, the Lord warned me because I hadn't stopped. That spirit husband would jump back into me. So a lot of times, you have a problem with your marriage. That's why. Stop looking at your husband as he's a weaker vessel. All because he's not praying the way you want him to pray. He's not acting the, you know, righteous the way you want him to act. God's not going to reward you based on how he does. He'll reward you based on how you do. Praise the living God. 22 say, but you are come into Mount Zion, into the seat of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to an innumerable company of angels. He said, to the general assembly and church of the firstborn, which are written in heaven, and to God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of just men made perfect, and to Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant, and to the blood of sprinkling that speaketh better things than that of Abel. See that ye refuse not him that speaketh, For if they escape not who refuse him that spoke on earth, much more shall not we escape if we turn away from him that speaks from heaven, whose voice then shook the earth. But now he hath promised, saying, ye once more I shake not the earth only, but also heaven. And this word, ye once more, signify the removing of those things that are shaken as of things that are made, that those things which cannot be shaken may remain. 28. Wherefore, we receiving a kingdom which cannot be moved, let us have grace whereby we may serve God acceptably with reverence and with godly fear. For our God is a consuming fire. See, Holy Ghost is a consuming fire. So we need to please God. Be obedient to him, your heart. Look unto Jesus, who's the author and finisher of faith. Whatever we're going through, we look unto him. Do not despise the chastening or correction of the Lord. So remember, he chastens or corrects those whom he loves. Praise his holy name. So again, I thank God for this meat, the meat of his word. So what you do, you just take your time and you and the Holy Ghost and go over this chapter. The Holy Ghost will reveal more revelation. Okay? So remember to live peaceably with everybody, and that means even with your spouse. For you to live peaceably with them. For you, he said, well, they're not living peaceably with me. God said, for you to live peaceably with them. Praise the living God. With all men, your co-workers, your supervisor, submit to God. Stay in his word. Then you'll be able to resist temptation. Okay? Amen. So I'm going to unmute everybody, and we're going to begin our prayer in Jesus' name. So, Father God, in Jesus' name, we just thank you for this opportunity given us, Father.
Thank you.
To minister your grace and mercy, to come together, Father, one with another. We thank you, Lord Jesus.
Thank you, Lord,
for everything that you have done for us, God. Thank you for keeping us, Lord.
Thank you.
Thank you for this understanding of your word that you have given us. Thank you for empowering us with your word, with your spirit to endure and bear all things. For our desire, Lord, is to glorify your name.
Thank you.
Thank you for ordering our steps in your word today, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
For it's not I, but it's you, Lord Jesus.
Glory to God.
And we thank you for your grace and mercy.
Thank you, Lord.
We give you praise. We give you all the
glory.
Father, there is unclean things that is in us. We ask you to rid it out of us. And we thank you, Lord, for giving us a love for your word. A love for your word, Lord, because we're about your word, Lord.
Yes.
We cannot
thank
do
you.
We can't do nothing.
Your word.
Thank you for your correction. We know that you love us, and that's why you correct us, Lord.
That comes through your word.
We glorify you. We magnify you.
Glory to God.
Thank you for strengthening us. Thank you for filling us with your spirit.
Thank you,
Lord.
And carry on your work, your will on this earth.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
For your grace, Lord. For your compassion.
Glory to God.
Thank you, Lord.
Glory to God.
Enabling us to endure.
Hallelujah.
And to bear it all.
Thank you, Lord.
We glorify you.
Glory to God. Thank you, Lord.
And we thank you, Father.
Hallelujah.
In Jesus' name.
Have your way. Have your way.
Thank you.
Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Have your way.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. For you are
worthy.
You are worthy. To be
your will, Lord. Your
will.
Yes,
your will.
We glorify you and magnify you always.
Glory to God.
Thank you, Lord. Continue to help us with your spirit. Fill us with your spirit, Lord. Fill us, Lord. So we can carry on your work. So we can endure all things and bear all.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you,
for your protection.
Thank you.
Thank you for protecting your children.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord Jesus, for releasing the captives. Thank you, Lord Jesus,
for wisdom.
Glory to God. Thank you. You're
dealing with these are the held captives. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for exposing the works of God.
Can you close it again?
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
We glorify you.
Thank you.
We magnify you, our faith. Thank you, Lord, for killing us.
Seek you, Lord.
Provide for us. Sustain us. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you,
Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Glory
to your holy name.
Glory to God.
Thank you, Jesus.
Glory to God.
Thank you,
Jesus. Thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
Glory to God.
Amen.
Glory to God. Thank you.
Yes. Yes, Lord.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jesus.
Lord, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Given up
from the living word.
Thank you, Jesus.
Glory to your name.
Thank you, Lord, for setting us
free. Glory to your name, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord, for making your name a fire. Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you.
Glory to your name.
Yes, Lord.
Glory to your name.
We glorify you.
Glory to your name.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Father. Amen. Amen. Yes. Yes.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen. Praise his holy name, behold.
Glory.
Just praise him and thank him for these shalom one in prayer. And these prayers is where he fills us up.
Jesus.
To overflow so he can continue doing his will on this earth. And I thank you. Praise him. Anybody want to share, pertain to what you heard, that the Holy Spirit has given you, just feel free to share in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. All right, now again, thank everybody for tuning in to this live broadcast. You know, it's a greater blessing when you tune in to the live broadcast. For those of you who are watching over the archive, come and tune in to the live broadcast. Go to the website, radio.holyghostfire.us, for instructions on how to install the LCC app on your mobile device or your computer, and you can join me, okay? So today, you know, the conference call started a new control panel. So I may end up broadcasting the live Shalom Prayer on my YouTube. So the Holy Ghost gave me a way that I can do that now, and it's free. The way the Holy Ghost tells me to do it is free. So I may start doing that, but even that, it's a greater blessing if you can tune in on the live broadcast. And you know, come on the live broadcast and don't be toggling TOGELING from the live broadcast to YouTube. Just a distraction. Don't be going back and forth. Stay on the live broadcast. Okay? That's a greater blessing. But I do have some people who do that. When I start posting on YouTube, they have both of the LCC app and YouTube, and they toggle back and forth. That's a distraction. You don't do that. You stay on the LCC app to the live broadcast, and you disconnect from YouTube. you two is for those who actually are non-believers, you know, who happen to be, you know, browsing around the YouTube, and the Holy Ghost will bring them to my channel. It's for them, not for you who regularly listen to the live broadcast, especially if you've been an intercessor, you're supposed to stay focused just on the live broadcast through the FCC app. Okay? Another greater blessing for you. So be sure to join me on tomorrow, Wednesday and Thursday at 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. I will have the one-on-one sessions, deliberate sessions. And my intercessors, please, you know, if you can, come on and join me to intercede. And for those of you who, again, you have a problem when you say holy, holy, holy from deep down within, you know, feel that hesitation, feel a little slight anger, or you just say, I ain't doing that. Well, that's sure telltale sign you need to be delivered. So call in on Wednesday and Thursday at 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Go to the website, radio.holyghost5.us, to get instructions on how to install the FCC app on your mobile phone or your computer. And then you enter for the online meeting ID, a female exorcist. And make sure now you, when you connect your audio, connect it to the internet. Not to your phone, but to the internet. So that, and also turn on your video so you can be seen and heard. Okay? Those instructions are on the website. Okay? Remember, all calls, all sessions with Vantage King, they are considered to be public since I record them and share them on all our programs. So you have to be willing to give your reputation. You have to be willing to despise the shame, just like Jesus. Okay? Remember, or I said, look unto him. Okay? Amen. So again, dear heart, I want everybody to stay blessed in Jesus' mighty name. Until the next time, I see. Okay? Shalom.
Shalom.
Amen.